I get asked all the time by rental property owners, is it better for me to do a long-term standard type of rental on my investment property, or would I be much better off listing that property on Airbnb and renting it on a short-term basis? And the answer in a lot of cases is it depends. But I freaking hate that answer. So in today's video, I want to do a side-by-side comparison of the same property so you can see how the same exact property would perform under a long-term scenario or under a short-term scenario. So recently, my buddy Nick called me up and let me know that he was moving from the Bay Area of California to a suburb right outside of Indianapolis.
Smart move, Nick.
And being the savvy investor that he is, he decided to purchase a house that has another house on the rear of the lot. So really, he's getting two houses in one. One that he's going to live in and one that he's using as a rental property. And knowing that I've done both long-term and short-term rentals and that more recently I've been really leaning heavily into the short-term rental strategy, he asked me which one would be the best option for the house in the rear of the lot. So I think I kind of pushed him toward the short-term rental model because that's what he ultimately landed on and it's now listed on Airbnb. But now that the property's been rehabbed and we can see the listing and see what it's renting for, we can compare apples to apples. So we're gonna see side by side if I'm the a-hole that pushed him into the wrong strategy or if Airbnb was the wise decision and I'm gonna be getting an extra nice Christmas card this year. I'm Kirby Atwell from Living Off Rentals, and I always say that I believe high quality rental properties are the best investment a person can make, and I'm about to show you why I believe that so firmly. So before I get too far into the rental numbers, I just want to do an overview of what the property looked like when he purchased it just a few months ago. So he bought this property for $300,000. So you can see here is the house that he's living in, the brick one. And then there's the little rental house next to it. So let's just take a look through the pictures here. So you can see how it's set up with one property in the front of the lot and then the other property in the rear of the lot. And it looks like the previous owner actually put more attention on the rental property than they did on their personal property. Here's a higher overhead picture of how the lot is set up. Both of them have a driveway to access. And so this is the rental property here. There's the property that he's living in. And so he bought these, both properties, again, for $300,000. He had to put $15,000 into the rental property and about $18,000 into the property that he's living in. So this is the property that they rehabbed and moved into. And then this is the rental property. Again, here, it's got a two-car garage. And it's really in great shape. I mean, it's got hardwood floors and really decent features that you could make look really high end pretty easily. And again, this is the setup of the actual property. So now I want to go through what that property looks like now with $15,000 of work done to it. And he got a lot done for $15,000. There was a lot to work with in this property. So if we look at the pictures here, you can remember it was all pretty much like natural wood tones. And so when we look at like the kitchen, you know, it already had stainless steel appliances. He just painted the lower cabinets a dark gray color and the upper cabinets white. It's really smart. I think this is the same backsplash that was there. So he really brought out the gray tones. And then he put in this LVP or luxury vinyl plank flooring, which everyone's putting in these days. I'm not sure what makes it luxurious, but that is what they call it. And so, you know, when we flip through these pictures, you can see like same countertops, I believe, but even if these are new ones, these are a few hundred dollars. They're not super expensive countertops. You know, he kept a ton of stuff, like he kept fixtures, and then, you know, he furnished it with some cool furnishings. And so it makes it look really high end. And he did a really, really good job with it. So this is what it looks like now. And you can see, you can keep in mind, it's $126 per night is what he's asking now in the off season. And now the moment that we've all been waiting for, the side-by-side comparison of the two strategies. And if you're about to do your own rental property, I highly recommend doing the same strategy, you know, comparing them apples to apples, side-by-side, and putting all the projections down based on actual comps of the two different types of rentals. You know, you can look up long-term rental comps. You can obviously look up on Airbnb other short-term Airbnb rentals that are similar to yours in the same location to get an idea of how often it's rented and for how much. So first, let's go through the left side of the spreadsheet, the long-term rentals over here. So I've got at the top the revenue. So for a long-term rental, typically it's just the rent. You know, you can charge a pet fee. This Airbnb, obviously you can tell by the name of it, it was called like Puptastic Airbnb. You know, they were indicating that it's very pet friendly. So one way of making extra revenue on a long-term rental is to charge a pet fee. And so I assumed in this rental rate that it's pet friendly. So looking at a bunch of other comps, rental comps in the area and seeing what's available, I assume that you could get about $1,800 per month on a long-term rental in the same property. So if you did the same rehab and you rented out on a long-term basis, it's gonna net you about $1,800 per month. So what are your expenses as a long-term rental property? Well, he bought the property for $300,000. Okay, so he had to put, typically, I don't know what the financing structure that he got on this property, but a lot of times people will put about 5% down on a property. You could put more down, but usually the minimum is about 5% down on a conventional loan. So assuming he put 5% down and got a loan for about 2.75%, which you can actually do better than that these days, which is crazy, but that would mean his mortgage payment would be $1,163. The taxes on both houses, which is also kind of insane, but welcome to Indiana from California, the taxes are $4,000 a year for both houses. So I put the entire cost in the expense column here, even though that means he's not paying any taxes on his own house that he's living in. We're putting the entire cost of taxes here. You could split it up, but I put the entire cost here. And then insurance, approximately about $1,200 per year. And so the entire cost of expenses is $1,596. And so there's two categories here that I always like to mention because they are expense categories, even though you're not going to be paying them on a monthly basis. Well, the expense set aside, you won't be paying on a monthly basis. But I always recommend tucking away 10 to 20% of the gross monthly revenue. So if it's 10% of 1800 bucks, it's going to be 180 bucks a month. You just put into an account. So it's sitting there accumulating so that when for sure something is going to break on your house, you know it will, everything's going to expire, you've got money sitting there. And so you've worked that into your numbers. So, you know, you can put whatever that number is in here. And then property management. So if you're going to do a long-term rental, maybe you manage it yourself, especially if it's in your backyard. A lot of times you're going to manage it yourself. But you know, you might hire a property manager. So typically on a long-term rental, you're going to pay 8 to 10% for management. So you can put those two numbers in here as well. I did not because, it's up to you on these costs, but they are costs, but let's say that, you know, you're handling those, you're just looking at the mortgage taxes and insurance costs. He's got now, if he was to do a long-term rental, he's got $204 extra per month. So he's literally eliminated his biggest cost out of his budget, which is housing. And on top of that, so he's living for free and it's like his house is paying him an extra $204 per month, which is pretty incredible. That's incredible. But even more so, let's look at the short-term rental side. So if you look at on Airbnb, you saw that in the off season, which right now in the Midwest, it's definitely the off season. So we listed it like right as we went are entering into the heart of the off season, which is the winter here in the Midwest. He's listing it for $126 a night. As soon as he listed it, he told me he got a 30-day booking. So pretty much the entire month of November is booked up. So that's a good indicator that the pricing is right when you get somebody who's willing to book it for 30 days at that price. So $126 per night in the off season, which means that in the high season, obviously he hasn't rented it in the high season yet, but it should rent very conservatively for about $189 per night in the high season, in the summer season when everyone's traveling. And a lot of times I get the pushback from people when I tell them they should rent their property on Airbnb. They're like, I'm in a random suburb. Like, what's gonna draw people here? And you know, why did somebody just book his house for 30 nights? You know, there's all kinds of stuff that draws people there. You know, sometimes it's to go to a hospital, or they have a family member in a hospital. Sometimes they're just visiting family for the holidays and they don't want to stay with the family. Or sometimes it's a work thing. And there's a million reasons. If you're anywhere close to a city, then you're gonna have bookings. There's a price where people will book with you, because the alternative is to stay in a hotel. So he sleeps six in this beautiful house, and in the high season, in the summer months, $189 a night is probably what he'd pay for a comparable hotel room that's just a room. You know, so if you've got several kids and you're traveling, they're going to decide to rent his house as opposed to renting a hotel, especially right now with COVID happening. So the numbers that I used, I was trying to be extremely conservative, but I used $126 per night in the off season, $189 per night in the high season, and I used a 70% occupancy rate. So I took half the year at 126, half the year at 189, and then I multiplied it by 0.7, because I'm just assuming 30% of the nights won't be booked. Now, in the summer season, most likely on all my Airbnbs, it's booked almost every single day. In the slower season, it's booked not nearly as much. It's usually like longer weekends and that sort of thing. So it's on average about 70%. So that equates to $3,353 in rental income on this property on a short-term basis, on average. It'll be higher in the summer, lower in the winter. Then if you have an average of 8 cleanings per month, you're gonna charge a cleaning fee on top of whatever your nightly rate is. So a lot of times it's around $100. You're gonna make an extra $800 in revenue on a monthly basis as well. Now, this is gonna go to your cleaner if you're using a cleaner, but it's an extra $800 of revenue. So he's grossing $4,153 as opposed to $1,800, which these numbers are pretty common numbers. If you've got a rental for $1,800, a lot of times you're gonna get somewhere around this $4,153 on a short-term basis. Sometimes it's gonna be higher, sometimes it's gonna be lower. Just depends where you're at, but that's the case for this area. So side-by-side comparison of revenue. Now expenses, obviously he's gonna have the exact same expenses on the short-term rental side that he had on the long-term rental side when it comes to the mortgage, taxes, insurance. So that stays the same. Expense set aside, I always recommend the same expense set aside. Your property's gonna stay in better shape over the long run with a short-term rental tenant in place because it's constantly being cleaned, but you also have to keep it up to a higher standard. So you still wanna set aside 10% to 20%. Then property manager for a short-term rental is 20 to 30% as opposed to 8 to 10. Why is that? It's because the property manager is gonna be doing a lot more. You know, typically as a property manager, you rent out the property on a long-term rental, you rent out the property, and then there's, you know, check-ins periodically, but it's pretty minimal in terms of your day-to-day work. With a short-term rental, obviously there's a lot more bookings and guests coming and going and more aspects to pay attention to on the property. So those two things will be the same as the long-term rental, but just a different number on them. Then the things that aren't the same on a short-term rental or additional costs, I guess, that you'll have. So the cleaning fees, I italicize this just like the ones above it, because you could keep this $800 if you wanted to. You could claim the property. So it is another source of income if you wanted to go that route. If you start to scale and have multiple Airbnbs, obviously you're probably not going to want or be able to clean all of them yourself anymore. But if it's on the back of your property, you know, we had one in our basement for the last several years, and my wife would clean it quite a bit, you know, because she was home with the kids and she could easily pop down there and clean it, and we would keep the cleaning fee as opposed to pay a cleaner. Then grass cutting and snow removal. Obviously, that's a fee that you're not going to pass on to your tenant like you probably would in a long-term rental. So I just estimated about $40 a grass, you know, $40 per grass cutting and do it every week. So $160 per month. Utilities, about $175 for water, gas, and electric. And then finally, $50 is what I pay in all my Airbnbs for about 100 megabytes per second download speed. So total, we've got $2,800 in expenses. So definitely higher expenses on the short-term rental side. But some of those, again, like the cleaning fee and the grass cutting and snow removal fee, that's an extra $1,000 that you don't have to pay to someone. That could go directly in your pocket if you're willing to be more hands-on. So what does that relate to? So if you were paying someone to clean it and someone to cut the grass, you would still make $1,352 per month. So again, what is he paying for his mortgage now? He's paying $0 to live, to have these two houses, and the house now is paying him $1,352 per month as opposed to him paying $1,163 per month to live there. So what most people do is they buy a house and they pay their mortgage for the next 30 years. They get a 30-year loan and they pay $1,163 per month for the next 30 years. So now this $1,163 is totally eliminated. No cost there, plus making an extra $1,352. And let's just say he decided that he wanted to cut the grass and clean the property himself. Now he's making an extra $2,312. So for some people who live really frugally, this could almost pay your house that you live in could almost pay you for all your expenses. You could live off the house or the property that you're living in. You know, it's two houses in this situation. So it's such a smart investment. I mean, if we just look at, let's say over the next 10 years, he was to make this $2,312. He would pretty much make the entire loan amount of his entire mortgage. So he's paid zero for the mortgage and he's made on top of it almost the entire mortgage amount over a 10-year period if you rented this out. And these are pretty conservative numbers. So I'm hoping that this means that I'm gonna get a Christmas card this year from him. I pushed him into doing the short-term rentals, and obviously nothing ever works out according to a spreadsheet. So there's gonna be ups, there's gonna be downs, there's gonna be other issues to deal with. And that's the thing. As a short-term rental property owner, you need to think through too, does it fit your personality? It is gonna be a little more hands-on. The great thing about the short-term rental industry now is that there's so many different ways to automate it. Really, the only thing you can't automate is the cleaning and maintenance. Everything else, all the guest registration, check-in, all of that stuff can be automated. You can hire a manager to do it. I always recommend doing it yourself first to learn the entire process, and you're much more better equipped to hire a manager. So hopefully this video was beneficial to you as you're looking at your next rental property and you're trying to figure out, should I go the short-term route or should I go the long-term route? If this was beneficial to you, give me a thumbs up. If it wasn't and you think this video was a big piece of crap, give me a thumb down. Either way, I appreciate your patronage on this video. Also, we have a great Facebook group. It's called Living Off Rentals Facebook group. And if you go over to Facebook and you search that, you can ask to join the group. There's about 550 members right now. Great investors hang out in that group. You can ask your question. You can get advice. You can listen to some of the podcasts because there's a lot of the podcast guests who are members there. So you can listen to the podcast. You can ask them questions there. Also, comment on this video and let me know what you got out of it. What was the biggest takeaway? Because I look at all those comments and I base future videos off of that. I hope to see you in the Facebook group, but if not, I'll see you in the next video.